Please join in our call to worship. Once again, as the season of Lent begins, we are summoned by a gracious and merciful God.
We respond to God's steadfast love, calling us together in grace.
Let us bow in awe before the one who creates.
We approach God in reverence and wonder, rejoicing in the invitation to holy places.
Walk humbly before God in secret disciplines, in prayer and fasting and giving.
We seek the one who grants us life, upholding us. Merciful God, lift these things from our hearts and free us to worship with you with grateful and humble hearts. Strengthen and renew us with your Spirit so that we may live as changed people, better able to follow Jesus, our Lord and Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen. Friends, be glad and rejoice, for grace abounds. Thanks be to God, who loves us and who forgives us. I invite you to stand and turn to those around you. And in this season when we are hearing so much in the news about viruses, I don't think the main one we're hearing about in the news has made it quite to Louisville yet, thanks be to God. But understanding that there's flu and many other things going around, how about we just do a little elbow bump? But you still have to accompany it with a smile, saying, may the peace of Christ be with you.
fruit of the tree that's in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die. But the serpent said to the woman, you will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you'll be like God, knowing good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. Lord, the Lord. Thanks be to God.
As we sing our children's song this morning, I invite the children to come and join me. Something about Easter, we're on the right track, yeah. Lent is a period of time before Easter, between Ash Wednesday, which we had this past Wednesday, and Easter. And it's a time in the church when we kind of stop and remember that we mess up a lot, you know. Of course, I don't know, are any of you guys perfect? I bet some of you never make any mistakes, never. Who never does anything wrong? Maybe I think we'll look at it too. Yeah, we all do things wrong. And that means that we need God in our lives to help us along the way. And so it's a time of remembering that, of admitting that we mess up sometimes. But it's also a time of remembering how much God loves us, and that even though we mess up, that God forgives us. And we kind of, hopefully we remember that all year, but this season, this time of year during Lent is a time we remember that especially. And we remember that God showed us that even though we mess up, that God loves us so much that God was willing to send Jesus to show us how much God loves us by even being willing to die. And so, maybe over the next few weeks, as you come to church, as you go to children's church, you'll think a little bit about that. Think about, gosh, I mess up a lot. God loves me anyway. Okay, let's pray. God, thank you for each of these young people sitting up here with me this morning. Thank you for loving them so very, very much. We know that we don't always do the things we should do, and sometimes we do things that we shouldn't do. But help us, God, to do better. Help us to remember that we are your dearly loved children. In Jesus' name. this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 4. It says, "Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, 'If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread.' But he answered, 'It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God.' Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, 'If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone.' Jesus said to him, 'Again, it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test.' Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, 'All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me.' Jesus said to him, 'Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him.' Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him." This is the gospel of Christ. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Pray with me. God, in these moments, words of my mouth, meditations of all of our hearts, be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, as I had mentioned already, this past Wednesday was Ash Wednesday, which marks the beginning of the season of Lent. And on that day, Christians around the world mark the day by being marked, usually on the forehead with a sign of the cross. And the mark is made using ashes that are obtained by burning the palms from last year's Palm Sunday worship service. And as they're being marked with those ashes, they hear the words, "Remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return." In other words, don't forget you're going to die. Now, taking it nothing more than face value, let's be honest, those words are something less than uplifting. But being reminded of our mortality is being reminded that we are human. And as human, that means that we are made in the very image of God, created by God, pronounced good by our Creator, created by God, just as the dust itself was created by God. And being human, this earthly life, it's a journey of sorts. Parts of that journey are joyful, euphoric sometimes even. Other parts of it can be painful. Parts of it are smooth and easy. Other parts, rough, rocky, dry, and arid. So, in recent weeks, as I thought about this Lenten journey that we're beginning, and we will continue over the next few weeks, I thought of that journey of life and of what can sustain us where we find our strength as well as our rest. And my mind kept returning over and over again to the hymn that we just sang, "Beneath the Cross of Jesus." Beneath the cross of Jesus, I gladly take my stand. Shadow of a mighty rock within a weary land. Just those first two lines, that they draw me in, shape my thinking as we begin the season of Lent. A weary land. I don't know about you, but it seems to me that everywhere I look, I see a weary land. If I look in other parts of the world, in Syria, I see a weary land, a land weary of war, where instead of the government making sure that their people are protected, the people are weary to the bone of being bombarded, literally bombarded, by their own government. In China, I see people who are weary of the virus and the toll that it's taking on them, the toll that is physical, but also emotional and even financial. In numerous parts of the world, I see a weariness from worry over the changes in our climate. Places where rising sea levels threaten not only their way of life, but their very existence. Other places suffering from lengthy droughts. Weary land. And in places in Central and South America, I see people weary from a threat of violence, to the point of being willing to risk everything for the chance, however slim it might be, of making it and having a new life in these United States. But there's a weariness here as well. We're wearied by all the hate, from racism and misogyny, homophobia, xenophobia. We're worried by an economic system that is growing the gap between the haves and the have-nots, where the very rich are doing very well, at least up until this past week. But the ranks of the poor, the very poor, are growing. We're wearied by all of the divisiveness, the vitriol, the rancor, the rhetoric, demonization instead of dialogue. We're just weary. In need of rest, in need of refreshment, need of the encouragement to go on. Well, I can't help thinking that by the end of his time in the desert, facing temptations, that Jesus must have been pretty weary. He was there a long time. The scriptures say 40 days, but 40 days not so much to be taken as a literal unit of time, but just to indicate that it was long, full period of time. And during that time, he was lacking food or a comfortable place to rest. And in those circumstances, he had to deal with temptations. Temptations that in some form or other, all of us deal with. Temptations regarding food. Tempted to put his desire for food above his identity and his relationship with God. Tempted regarding how to understand the scriptures. Tempted to follow a literal reading of the scriptures as a litmus test of faith. Tempted regarding power. Tempted by a status of being admired by and having power over other people. Melinda Quibbick sums it all up kind of by saying, food, simplistic thinking, and self-importance are what is at stake here. We all deal with those kinds of temptations, don't we? Those issues. But however weary he was, Jesus withstood them. And the story tells us that once he had passed that test, that angels came and waited on him. Now, however literally you may wish to take that, simply know that he found the sustenance and the rest that he needed in a weary land. What about us? We live in a land that, in one way or another, has been weary, is weary, and let's face it, will always be in this lifetime a weary land. That's not being fatalistic, it's just recognizing that in so many ways, life is hard. It doesn't mean that we give up working to make things better. It doesn't mean that we give up working for justice. It doesn't mean that we give up doing the work of love that God has for us to do. It's just acknowledging that we get weary. And that's part and parcel of the journey. Knowing that we have those times when we are just weary, we need to find a place where we can find sustenance, a place to rest. Angels may not be coming wearing aprons and carrying pads on which to write down our orders. So, I will offer to you that we must regularly make our way to the cross, to the shadow of a mighty rock within a weary land. You see, it's there that we are reminded of the depth of the love of God. It's there that we can rest in that assurance. It's there that we can find strength for the journey ahead. Another thing we find beneath the cross of Jesus, in that shadow of a mighty rock within a weary land, is that we're not alone. We're not alone there. There is community there. There are our fellow travelers to be found there. Now maybe they're weary too, but we can hold one another up. We can encourage one another. We can offer support and strength to each other and share in that. We may not be the angels who came and waited on Jesus, but we can be one another's angels, in a sense. I was talking to someone recently about music, about the music that we listened to when we were teenagers. And I mentioned that since I'm the youngest in my family, I have the baby of the family, yes. I had older brothers and sisters, and so I kind of grew up listening to a lot of the stuff that they were listening to and gravitated towards some of that. So even though I was really pretty young when Simon and Garfunkel split up and went their separate ways, I always loved a lot of their music. I thought of their biggest hit the other day as I was thinking about this message. The first verse of Bridge Over Troubled Waters, as these lines. When you're weary, feeling small, when tears are in your eyes, I'll dry them all. I'm on your side, Lord, when times get rough and friends just can't be found, like a bridge over troubled water. I will lay me down. We can be each other's bridges during those times of troubled waters, of rough going. We need that reminder. We need each other. We live in a weary land, but we can find what we need beneath the cross of Jesus. Last month, a group of 54 people from the Indiana-Kentucky Conference of the United Church of Christ traveled to Arizona to witness what is happening at our southern border and to learn about the reality of the situation there. Among that group was our conference minister, Chad Abbott. And upon their return, Chad wrote a reflection about the trip, and it included this story that I want to share with you. He writes, "One of the other trips I took on this journey in Arizona was a migrant memorial trail route. We walked the desert where there were remains of individuals found by Samaritans. People from our UCC church there in Arizona placed memorial markers and crosses where these beloveds of God were found. As we walked, we prayed, sang hymns, read poetry, and offered liturgy to embody the presence of God in that moment. It was a place of bearing witness. We shouted, 'Presente,' together at the end of each site visit because it means here or present. The leader asked us to listen for the complexity of the mystery of presence and absence." In other words, presente says, the person who died here is no longer here, but we are here and bearing witness to God's ever-loving presence in this place so that they will not be forgotten. The final site we visited on this walk was of a teenage boy. I stood less than 5 feet from his memorial cross as we gathered. We stood in silence for a time. The leader asked if anyone had anything they would like to say to this young man. People responded with, "I'm sorry, we'll see you soon." Some prayed a song. But at one point, a teenager in our midst said, "You know, my mom used to sing to me, 'You Are My Sunshine.' Maybe we could sing that together." As a parent to a teenager myself, and as a parent who has and who continues to sing that very song to my children, this young man that I stood before was my son, and the son of all who was bearing witness to his life that day. Presente. There was a sadness in that moment, to be sure. There was also peace, a joy, and a hope that can only spring from the very God that created us all. In this weary, weary land, God is presenting, is here with us. May we find and share joy, peace, and the hope that God offers in this Lenten season and always. Amen.
Please stand as you're able and join as we recite our affirmation of faith.
as I lead us this morning in a time of prayers of intercession and petition, praying for needs among our community and in our world. I invite you to offer up the prayers, the concerns and burdens of your heart this morning as well. Let's pray. God of earth and sky, we pray today for those living in lands weary with war and violence. We pray for those who suffer in Syria, for mothers, fathers, for children. We pray for a just peace in that land. We pray for people in Central and South America who live daily with violence in their streets from gangs and others. We pray for families there faced with hard choices. Pray that they might have a home and have lives that are safe, wherever that might be. We pray for peace and justice in these and other weary lands. Christ, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of mercy, we pray today for lands that are weary with sickness and dis-ease. Pray for those suffering with a virus not fully understood. We pray for those seeking to better understand and thus better treat that sickness. We pray today for those in areas living whose sickness is due to a lack of clean water, a lack of proper nutrition, a lack of other resources, or lack of adequate, available, and affordable health care. We pray that the human family would learn to better care for and about one another. Christ, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy One, as we embark on our journey through this season of Lent, help and guide us in our introspection. Illuminate for us those corners of our lives that have become dark due to our own actions that have shut out your light. May we become more open, more honest with you and with ourselves. Help us to give up those things, those practices, those habits in our lives that inhibit us from walking more fully in your way of love. We know that this is not a quick journey, not an overnight process. And so help us to be patient with ourselves, even as you are patient with us. Help us, O God, to find our way and to find all that we need for the journey beneath the cross of Jesus. Christ, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear us now as we pray. Pray as you have taught us, O God, our Mother, our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen.
God has given us the gifts we need to live full and generous lives. We offer our gifts and ourselves to God in gratitude for the possibilities we enjoy, trusting God to multiply what we bring. May we give in faith.
Thank you.
offering, strengthen those who are resisting temptation, and lead us to attend to all who need your healing touch. This we pray in the name of Jesus, our example and our Savior. Amen. This morning, as we prepare to come to the table, let me pause just a moment to mention a couple of things we're going to do a little bit differently, recognizing that this is a time of year of illnesses and viruses over and beyond the one that we, as I mentioned earlier, are hearing about in the news. And so we're going to take some steps to try and cut down on any spread, anything like that. The two of us this morning who will serve at the table, serving the body of Christ, serving the bread, will be using some hand sanitizer before we begin, and we will take a piece of bread and place it in your hands rather than having you reach into the plate. And I would just ask then, as you dip the bread into the cup, endeavor to dip only the bread into the cup and not your fingertips. Hopefully we will all stay healthy and be here to share the joy of coming to Christ's table again next week. Be mindful also, as I often say, that this is the table of Christ. And no matter who you are or where you are on your life's journey, you are welcome here. And so come, you weary and restless, all who hunger and thirst, Jesus calls us to dine as friends. Come, for God's feast awaits us. The Lord is with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
It is right to give thanks to the Holy One.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
You created us, O God, to live in communion with you, yet we turned away.
We come during this Lent season, knowing our failings, but trusting your steadfast love.
We come, reflecting on the mystery of the cross.
We dare to call on the resurrection.
We remember that on his final evening with his disciples, Jesus took bread. When he had given thanks, broke it, and gave it to them, saying,
"This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
And after supper, doing the same with the cup, he said,
"This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood."
In remembrance of these, your mighty acts, on our behalf, we bring you our whole selves as we proclaim the mystery of our faith.
Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again.
So pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and cup. May this meal be for us signs of your great mercy, forgiveness of our sins, and promise of salvation. Please join me in our prayer of thanksgiving. Thank you, merciful God, for gladness in this bread and cup, for love that cannot buy, for peace the world cannot give, for joy in the company of friends, for the splendors of creation, and for the vision of justice you have made our own. Give us the gifts of this Holy Communion, oneness of heart, love for neighbors, forgiveness of enemies, the will to serve you every day, and life that never ends. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. We take just a brief moment, as brief as I can make it this morning, to call your attention to the news and notes section of your bulletin. For those who are watching live stream, you don't have a bulletin, but I'll try and share a little bit about what's going on in the life of the church here at St. John. We are continuing, we began this morning, but we will be continuing our book discussion group meeting on Sunday mornings at 9 a.m. in the parish house, discussing Richard Rohr's little book entitled Just This. And if you weren't there this morning, but you would still like to join us, you are more than welcome to do so. Just get a copy of the book and begin reading just one of the short sections that the book is made up of each day, and we will gather again next Sunday morning for that. This Tuesday evening is our monthly Libations and Conversation gathering at Fall City Brewing, as usual. Information there regarding that in your bulletin. Next Saturday is our local United Church of Christ Association Spring Church Leadership Conference, and then a very short associational meeting to go with that. There are several things there that I would love for us to have people there to learn about. Things like websites and security and all kinds of things that are pertinent to the life of the church. So if you would be interested in going, let me know and we'll make sure that you get registered. You don't have to pre-register, but I think it will help our hosts out at St. Andrews to know how many to expect. So if you have questions, please see me. Just another week to get in orders for Easter lilies if you'd like to have a lily placed in the sanctuary in honor or in memory of someone. Please be mindful of that. And 2 weeks from today, we are going to be receiving new members as part of our worship. If you are interested in being part of that, or if you know someone who might be, please have them contact me by Wednesday, March the 11th. We'll be receiving members on March the 15th into the family here at St. John. And then one other announcement. You may have noticed when you came in this morning, if you parked in back, that a lot more activity has been going on with our new neighbors who have purchased the parish hall. They've begun some work in earnest this week, and it's very possible that a construction fence may be going up across the parking lot. So it is all the more important to be mindful of where you park. First of all, don't block in if there is equipment here. Don't block that in. But also, on Sunday mornings, for those of us who are young and in great health, well, sort of good health anyway, and are capable of walking a little further, leave the parking lot for those for whom mobility is a little more of an issue, and for our guests to use. Southern Tire, which is just at the other end of our block, is a short walk. They have a nice-sized parking lot there, and they very graciously offered for us to use it on Sunday morning. Their business isn't open on Sunday mornings anyway, and they're very kind to say that's fine if we park there. I'm parking there regularly on Sundays now, and encourage others of us to do the same. Again, leaving the spaces that are here in the parking lot more for our older members and for those who have mobility issues, and for, as I said, for our guests, so that if somebody wants to come and be a part of our worship for the first time, we're not expecting them to walk far or to have to hunt for a parking location somewhere else. So that's kind of what's going on in the life of the church. Be aware of those things and come be a part of what you can. We're going to continue now in worship. I invite you, those who are are able in body or in spirit to stand as we sing our closing hymn together. In the name of God, Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit.